3 years ago, COVID shutdowns rocked live music venues across the nation. Hit the hardest were smaller, independent venues who were already facing high costs and corporate competition. Fast forward to 2023, and the Atlantis, a new 450-person music venue, just opened to immense excitement here in Washington, D.C.
The tagline of the Atlantis is, "Where music begins." It really is.
Audrey Fick Schaefer is the communications director for IMP, which owns multiple venues, both large and small, in the Washington, D.C. area, including the Atlantis.
It's where it begins for artists that are just emerging and they need to get exposure to new audiences and hopefully to develop and be able to grow into the bigger venues.
And small venues like the Atlantis create a special, intimate experience for artists and their fans, says IMP chairman and owner Seth Hurwitz.
I mean, here I am standing, sitting in front of the stage, you're sitting in basically the back of the floor, and we're right next to each other. This is an excitement. When you see a band like that, there's nothing like it.
And fans are indeed excited. Before the Atlantis opened this summer, there were over 500,000 requests for tickets for the opening series of 44 shows. And that's a far cry from the struggles that IMP and other groups who run live music venues, both large and small, faced during the pandemic, when all of IMP's venues were forced to shut down for 18 months, only able to reopen once vaccinations became widely available. And as an independent music venue company, IMP had no backing from corporate entertainment juggernauts like Live Nation Ticketmaster, but still had bills and other expenses piling up.
Being shut down for more than 2 days was unthinkable. Before COVID, independent music venues were just that, really fiercely independent, and there was no way that they would come together on anything because if you were an independent across town, you were a competitor.
To stay afloat, independent venues acted quickly to form the National Independent Venue Association, or NIVA. In under a month, NIVA had thousands of members across all 50 states. Their first priority? Lobby Congress for specific relief, or what would become known as the Save Our Stages Act. Audrey Fick Schaefer is also a board member of NIVA and was influential in helping it get off the ground.
NIVA did a survey of its members pretty early on and found out what at first I found to be absolutely shocking, but then it made perfect sense. 90% of the members said that they would be shuttered forever if there was not emergency relief.
But even with government help, these venues still had major expenses.
We didn't have any revenue, you know, except some t-shirts that folks were kind enough to buy.
Dayna Frank is co-founder of NIVA and CEO of Minneapolis-based First Avenue Productions, which owns independent venues around Minneapolis and St. Paul.
You know, just because we didn't have any revenue, it didn't mean we didn't have any expenses, right? We still had rent, we had real estate taxes, we still had to have insurance.
And if 90% of independent venues had in fact closed, it would have had a lasting impact on the businesses surrounding these venues as well.
When people buy a ticket to a small venue, the economic impact of $1 spent on a ticket actually equals $12 in local economic impact. So you don't just go to a show, right? You also buy some drinks at the show, you go to dinner before, you buy a new outfit for the show.
The Save Our Stages Act, co-sponsored by Senators Amy Klobuchar and John Cornyn, would become the Shuttered Venue Operators Grant, administered through the Small Business Administration and passed in 2020 as part of a COVID-19 relief bill. It allocated over $15 billion for independent venues, such as music venues, theaters, and even nonprofit museums, giving them a temporary lifeline.
So without the grant money, there would have been no way of coming out of all those expenses with anything close to a fiscally responsible business.
That smaller, independent venues could keep their business afloat until they could reopen mattered to artists too.
Venues are churches. You know, it's like a place where the spirit can move.
Bartiz Strange is a recording artist who will be performing in September in one of the Atlantis's opening series of shows. With streaming revenues paying artists fractions of cents per stream, artists need a healthy marketplace of different size venues to build up their fan base.
There's nothing cooler than, you know, putting out a record, playing for 100 people, and then coming back to that city and there's 500 people. And you're like, wow, like this is working.
Independent venues are pivotal to emerging and working class artists. So in order for an artist to really hone their sound, build their community, build their fan base, and build a long-term sustainable career, they, you know, in most cases have to tour.
But as the pandemic shifted into a different phase and demand for live music returned, challenges for independent venues continued to exist.
Running independent venues and being an independent promoter was never easy. It is definitely harder now than ever before. We've seen a number of changes post-pandemic, you know, one being our insurance costs have doubled, tripled.
Add that they face competition from major corporations such as Live Nation Ticketmaster, who can secure rights for entire nationwide tours, place them exclusively at their own venues, and control everything from ticketing to production. But post Save Our Stages Act, the cooperation built by NEVA and independent venues and promoters have allowed them to come together to counter that.
Detour is a collective of local independent promoters that have come together to be able to buy national tours and to be able to route bands through, you know, primary, but also secondary and tertiary markets.
Additionally, NEVA is organizing to take on predatory practices by ticket resellers, who buy tickets with the sole purpose of reselling them at a higher price, or sell speculative tickets before they even go on sale.
Consumer is somebody who buys a ticket with the intent of going to the show. And so, you know, we are kind of facing up against this perspective that brokers are actually consumers, when really what they're doing is sweeping up inventory, controlling inventory to maximize their own prices on the secondary market. That is hugely, hugely damaging to our fans.
When fans buy from resellers, not from other fans who can't make the show, the additional money doesn't help venues or artists. The artists and venues also lose out on a way to market their upcoming shows or new music directly to the fan who bought from a ticket reseller.
I think the estimates are something like 30 to 40% of money spent on tickets are actually bleeding outside of folks that are responsible or have any kind of impact over the show itself.
For the Atlantis' opening shows, IMP sells tickets but doesn't issue them until a day before the show. And IMP's ticketing interface won't allow tickets to be resold for more than face value.
We don't want to see consumers gouged. We don't want to see the money going to people that had nothing to do with the cost of putting on the show. The artist should get the money. The venue that took the risk should get the money, not third parties that are parasitic.
And for artists like Bartiz Strange, the payoff of those efforts is more than monetary.
In a independent venue, you have kind of like the leeway to kind of have like a more personal relationship with like fans and the community, and you can play a bigger role in the community. You need places like this to like foster community, and you know, you can't have too many.
And that kind of support might just be music to independent venues' ears. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Tim McPhillips.